Then gratuity, yes, basic DA, HRA, conveyance allowance and commission. Again, five components are there. 12,000, 4,000, 6,000, 6,000, 6,000. Total comes to 34,000. Now we will work, calculate a gratuity on basic and DA alone, 16,000. I think that is also not questioned anywhere, any by any authority, right? But as per the new definition, at least 50% should be the wages. So the deemed wages would be 17,000. So if this person has completed 20 years of service on a continuous basis, I think then you may have to calculate gratuity amount for 20 years, considering 17,000 as salary, not 16,000. So in this fashion, in fact, the financial commitment can go up, right? So I think we have come to the end of the code on social security. I just thought we can give that specific example so that people can understand in a better fashion, right? But I'm not very sure. Let us wait for the rules or maybe guidelines or any other notification which may change the position, right? As I think Justice Vaidyanathan put it in his inaugural speech, we may require some clarity, right? Let us see. Now I think we'll move on to the last code, industry relations code. Let us go through the salient features. First itself is fixed term employment, right? I think it is permitted now, because again, the standing orders, it getting subsumed into this code, right? Trade Unions Act, Industrial Employment Standing Orders Act, and the Industrial Disputes Act. All the three legislations are now getting subsumed into Industrial Relations Code, right? But as per the standing orders only, I think the class of workers are listed, right? I think fixed term employment is also defined in this code for that purpose. And again, I think we discussed a lot about this. It can be for a specific period, right? So whatever is agreed between the individual employee and the employer as per the contract they have entered into. If it is for 3 years, then he will continue to be employee for 3 years. If it is for 4 years, then he will continue to be employee for 4 years. But at the end of 3 years or 4 years, he will be entitled for all benefits, which normally for which the permanent employees of the company are entitled to. That is how it is, right? So even if it is less than 5 years, then I think he must be paid gratuity, but that can be worked out on pro rata basis. Then the term industry, it is defined, right? Again, term is defined under the Bangalore Water Supply and Sewerage Board case as early in 1978, right? I think somehow the definition, I think it contains three ingredients. There must be a systematic activity. That activity must be carried out with the cooperation of the management and the workers, the employer and the employees, right? And it is ultimately for the purpose of fulfilling human wants or wishes. And that is the reason, in fact, that the spiritual activities, those are all excluded, right? Religious activities excluded, right? Sovereign functions excluded, right? So if these three ingredients are present, then that place will be considered as an industry. That is how it is. I think now it is getting into the statute books. And the definition of strike now will include mass casualty. I think this has been one of the requests of the employers for quite a long time. And if 50% or more of the workers as a concerted action, if they go on casual leave, mass casual leave, then that could be considered as strike. Then supervisors drawing more than 18,000 will not be treated as workers. So whoever is drawing, so supervisors, if they are drawing less than 18,000, only those persons will be treated as workers. If they are getting more than 18,000, then they will be considered as supervisors, not as workers, right? I think this limit was 10,000 earlier, then I think 15,000 was suggested. Now finally it has ended up with 18,000. I think same thing for interstate migrant workers also, whether that person is engaged directly by the employee or through the contractor. If the salary goes beyond 18,000, then that person will not be treated as ISMW, interested migrant worker, right? Then I think it provides for the obligation on the part of the industrial establishments pertaining to mines, factories, and plantations having 300 or more workers to take prior permission of the appropriate government before getting into layoff, retrenchment, or closure. I think the famous current Chapter 5B, now it is coming under Chapter 10, right? So instead of 100, now the threshold limit is getting increased to 300. So those industrial establishments which are into mines, factories, or plantations, if they have more than 300 workers, then they may need to take permission, if at all, if they resort to layoff, retrenchment, or closure, right? And it empowers the appropriate government to exempt any industrial establishment from any of the provisions of the code in the public interest for the specified period. That is a special provision given. We may have to check for the other details with respect to this.